ॐ सहना भवतु सहना भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। अनुपश्य यथा पूर्वे
अनुपश्य यथा पूर्वे
प्रतिपश्य तथा परे
प्रतिपश्य तथा परे
सस्यमिव मर्त्यः पच्यते
सस्यमिव मर्त्यः पच्यते
सस्यमिवाजायते पुनः
सस्यमिवाजायते पुनः।
अनुपश्य
अनुपश्य
आलोचय
आलोचय
निभालय
निभालय
अनुक्रमेण
अनुक्रमेण
येन प्रकारेण
येन प्रकारेण
वृत्ताः
वृत्ताः
पूर्वे
पूर्वे
अतिक्रांताः
अतिक्रांताः
पितृ
पितृ
पितामहादय
पिता महादय
पितृपिता
महादय
पितृपिता महादय तव तव। हियर द चाइल्ड हैज बिकम फादर या हैज बिकम द टीचर बिकॉज ही इज इमोशनली इनकेपेबल ऑफ मेकिंग द करेक्ट डिसीजन दैट इट्स नॉट ऑल अबाउट हिम एनी मोर यू नो दिस इज व्हाट हैपेंस And things come out of the mouth. It's no longer about oneself because the sound waves go to the universe. And what do? They just take on a life of their own. And then what has come out of your mouth becomes a line, you know, is archived already. This is fascinating. It's already archived socially. Culturally, you know, in the genealogically, it's archived. It has gained a life of its own. You no longer own it. This is what happens because the intellectual property right, because, you know, this thought came out of my head. Not true. Because it lives. Words live. You know, they have their own karma, they have their own life. When they will become famous, when they will become infamous, you don't know. You know, you may have said something just in passing and, you know, 10 years later suddenly it has become famous and it catches, how do they say it, goes viral. Yeah. Words have their own karma. And likewise, whether the words add to the socio-cultural situation, the genealogical situation, whether they add to it, augment it, or whether they stand out like a sore aberration, that also you don't, it's out of your control. So better, you know, if your speech cannot be in line with what your action is going to be, better go back and make the action in line with what you have said. This is what it is. This is an ethically upright culture. We have talked a lot about this, and the Bhashya just augments what has already been discussed. Very beautiful. So the speech is not in line with how I normally act. I just told somebody I'll give $1,000. It is completely out of character for me to have said that. Why should I give someone $1,000? There is no reason in heaven or earth to do that. Am I out of my mind? Why did I make this promise? Well, I must have not meant it. That's all. You know? But then, this is out of character, correct? For me to have said that. But then, having said that, I bring my character in line with the speech. That is a reparation. Yes. And the first part of the story is all about reparation. This is the first reparation. And in fact, in the student Vedantin's life, who is a Vedantin?
Yeah.
One who is in Vedanta. Yeah. Or one who is wanting to be in Vedanta. In a Vedanta student's life, reparation has a very important place. Reparation in Sanskrit is called? Prayaschitta. Close. Prayaschitta. The cleansing of the heart. So the reparation has a very important place, and to show that all this discussion, otherwise why to create this story and this dialogue and everything? And the reparation is really 9/10 of preparation. Yeah. You just have to, you know, now preparation is really nothing but reparation. You know, making amends. And here we don't stop by just saying, oh, sorry, I didn't mean that. Oops. You know, you don't do that. You know, that is extremely careless, culturally and socially careless. It's like leaving a mess behind and saying, oops, you know, why did you drop and leave a big horrible trail of something behind you? Oh well, no, not oh well, go back and clean it up, you know, clean it up. And this is the cleaning up. And since the aberration or the wrong action was in the form of words, and interestingly, words, you know, the speech is an organ of action. So really speaking, it's an act. When you talk, it's not, you cannot say talk is not action. Talk is a form of action, because karmendriya, when you count all the organs of action, speech is counted among the organs of action. So when you act, and even if it is speech, you have to clean it up, you know. Otherwise it will be like irresponsible ways of behaving. You know, from individual to corporations, we see that. They spill a lot of oil and then, you know, and then they go home. And somebody is getting rich off of all this. And so whether it's oil spill or other ecological disasters, you have to be able to, that is what is about, all about individual responsibility. Reparation is about individual responsibility. And making amends, you know, because speech is an organ of action, making amends has to not be just taking back the words, because they are already out. How are you going to take them back? Like I said, they have infiltrated the sound waves, sound bites. And therefore what? You need to unleash another set of actions which are going to repair, make an attempt to repair what happened. And this is not done out of a sense of guilt or, you know, writhing in self-blame and self-pity. It is done from a place of being proud of one's lineage and one's self in it, and from a place of responsibility. This is a very different thing. It's not about malingering and feeling sorry for oneself. No. One admits, you know, there is a certain greatness in admitting that, okay, this was an error of judgment. This was against the best of my judgment. Perhaps had I done this differently, or had I more time to think about this, perhaps my actions would be different. Had I known what would have all the whole situation, I would have acted differently. In fact, there is humility in that. There is a humility, and that humility is very beguiling, it's very alluring, it's very attractive in a person. You know, especially in a person of knowledge. You know, see, if you are, if one is rich, the abhushana, abhushana means alankara. Alankara means the ornament. The ornament for the rich person is magnanimity, really. What's the point otherwise of having riches if you cannot even open your hand and, you know, in case some loose change drops? Yeah. Ornament for the rich person is magnanimity. is the ability to be able to give, augments the riches of the rich person. Because the richness is not just having to do with the items or the, you know, big house or the material possessions. The richness is augmented by having a richness in the heart. That magnanimity is really the true riches of that rich person. So the rich person must be magnanimous. You know, a strong person, someone who is, this was Dhanavan, right? Dhanavan should be magnanimous. And then Balavan. Balavan means what? The one who can squash another person just by looking at them. So strong. Yeah. They can, you just, all they have to do is look at another person and the other person becomes flatter than a roti, you know. Yes, roti means Indian pancake, okay. Yeah. So flatter than a chapati the person becomes, and they have so much strength. And such a strong person must, what is the abharana, what is the, you know, what is the alankara for that? What is the adornment for the person who is insanely strong, you know? Compassion towards the vulnerable. Compassion. Must be able to see that, okay, everybody is not like that. That helpfulness and compassion must be there. They're ready to help, ready to be able to use the strength, not to keep on oiling the biceps and showing off the six packs and, you know. Yeah. And for the one who is Vidyavan, the one who has knowledge, any kind of knowledge, Paravidya, Paravidya. This, the ornament, abhushanam, abharanam, the ornament is humility. Yes. That's what the Gita also says. Vidya vinaya sampanne, brahmane gavihastini, shuni chaivashvapakecha, panditaha, samadarshinaha. So there is a, you know, there is an outcome of that, that vinaya is not just servitude and groveling, it's a true understanding that everything is given, and if one is in a place of knowing, it's because all the forces have bent backwards to allow myself to be in this position. Yeah. And in fact, the more you know, the more you say you don't know. This is natural, a natural outcome of knowledge. And so such a person, who Vidya and Vinaya go together, and being equipped, sampanne, you know, being endowed with this, and then what, the person becomes a person of equanimity, samadarshi, with regard to a brahmana. You know, brahmana means some religious person. You know, there is not some kind of, oh brahmana, oh, there is not that, ha, no. It's just a religious person, same attitude. With regard to a cow or an elephant, same attitude. And these are all considered auspicious symbols. Unless you see one, if you see one brahmana on the road, it's bad luck. Yeah. Two of them, okay. Three of them, more the merrier. Eka brahmana, you have to go home and take a bath. And whatever you are going for is not going to succeed. I don't know why. Yeah, the singleton brahmana is maligned. Yes. And so, otherwise, it's these three, the cow, the elephant and the brahmana, are actually pleasant things. So with pleasant things also one is has equanimity because of this knowledge and humility. What about the unpleasant things? Shuni, dog. You know, we don't put the dog on the bed and under the covers. No. Dog means it remains outside. Yeah. You know, you may throw it the leftover rotis. That's all. If it comes wagging the tail and wanting to climb on you, you don't allow it. You know? Yeah, and it knows that also. It will not climb. And so, we don't have a good association with a dog, you know. And then dog also, at least, you know, on occasion it does mischievous and cute things. But what about the one who cooks the dog and eats it? Shvapakaha. Yes, shvapak is the one who eats the dog. You know, it's very difficult to have a sense of equanimity. Equanimity means I separate the person from the conduct. I can abhor the conduct, but with regard to the person, I have equanimity. This is what the whole thing is. And so here, Vajashrava, you know, is described in the beginning as having the resources he's rich, he's well educated because he knows all about these yagas, he's knowledgeable, he's rich, he's strong enough to feed the whole, you know, neighborhood, and strong enough to do this Vishvajit mentally, physically, he's strong. And so here he has to, the Nachiketa says, you have to walk the talk. And walking the talk here, because the talk has already been uttered, you shouldn't even go to the place of trying to falsify this. You have to walk the talk. You have to practice what you preach, because whatever you have said is no longer your own intellectual property right. The words have escaped and joined the archives of everything that everybody has said. And this is what he says. Anupashya. Anupashya, he explains as Alochaya. Alochaya means sit down, have a glass of coffee and introspect. Yeah. Alochaya. You know? Think. Consider. And then he explains it further. Nibhalaya. Bhal, to shine the light. So Nibhalaya means shine the light on this situation. Yeah. You can add 2 plus 2. You know Purva and Apara connection. What happened before and afterwards. You know how to connect the dots. Think about this. You know, sit down. Take a deep breath. Here's a paper bag. You know. Maybe the bag was made of dried leaves in those days. You know, so to get some carbon dioxide going. So that your hyperventilation stops. So calm down. Have a cup of tea. And Nibhalaya, think about this, shed the light of your own knowledge on what Anukramena Yatha. Anukramena means just as in the past, Yatha, Yena Prakarena, in what order, Vrittaha, the conduct, Purve, Atikrantaha, means how did they, you know, how did they, Purve means the elders in the past, the ancestors, how did they negotiate their conducts? Whose elders? Tava, your own elders. And who are they? Pitru and Pita Mahadayaha. Pitru, father, and then father's father, and then he doesn't say father's father's father, etc. He stops there. Adi, you know, Adi means etc. So, you know, please see how their conduct, you know, was in keeping with the culture, the dharma. That is not said, we have to extrapolate here. How their conduct never violated the dharma. Do you see that? Do you see that? And do you, you know, can you think about that for a little bit? You know, getting past or suspending your sorrow about my imminent departure. Can you see this? And then he says, so what should I do after I see this? Tan drishtva.
तेषां
वृत्तं
आस्थातुमर्हसि.
Thinking about the Purvajas, thinking about those that were born before and how they conducted their life is not for the sake of writing a biography of them. You're not taking up the quill to write a novel here. Why should I look at their conduct? So that I don't cross that. Asthatum, so that I can, astha, a plus tha means in every way that I can, that is in my power, I don't falsify the conduct, their conduct. Because my conduct has gone and my conduct will be soon archived along with my words, just as theirs was. So it's no longer about me. And my son here, what is it about? It's about the conduct and the uprightness of the lineage that has never been violated by anyone ever in the past. So he says that, you know, tan drishtva, seeing this, you know, don't sit down to write a biography, but tesham vrittam, their conduct, asthatum, in order to establish, re-establish, keep it going, sustain their conduct, Tum arhasi, you deserve to do this. You deserve to reenact their conduct and thereby reiterate what this lineage, this culture, this society, this dharma stands for. Okay? Vartamanascha
apare
sadhavah
yatha
vartante
tamscha
pratipashya
alochaya.
Yeah, so, and don't stop there, because then you'll have a complex. Like, oh, I'm the only one who thought like this, nobody else thought like this. And then, or you'll have another complex. What? Oh, they are all dead and gone. How do I know how they behave? How do we know that they didn't behave like this? So what's wrong with behaving like this? You may have either of the two reactions depending on your mind state. Therefore, what? See how others are behaving now. Apare. Apare means others. But then, there it leaves a little gap there when you say apare. Why? Because apara means anyone. Anyone, right now, others. And then, what if someone were to say, what about the serial killer sitting in the jail? Yeah. How did the serial killer manage to have so many victims? Well, he infiltrated their houses, not by saying that, oh, you know, I'm coming, you know, to kill you. Nobody would have let them in the house. What might he have said? He would have said, I'm coming to check on the lights. Or you ordered a plumber, so I'm here to do some plumbing. I'm an electrician. Whatever he might have said to gain entry into the house is not the truth, correct?
Yeah.
So if you say apare, it includes everyone who is behind bars. You know, there are many kinds of bars. You know, the bars which you are behind. Bars in which you sit in front of. So all kinds of bars are included. But what does this mean, barring those people? That's why we have the word sadhavaha. Like the holy people, people who do good. Parakaryam sadhnoti iti sadhu. That is the derivation of the word sadhu. Is that the one who lives for others' benefit? Is a sadhu. Parakaryam means who works for tirelessly for the benefit of others. That is a sadhu, who puts the benefit of others ahead of their own benefit and who lives for others. So look at such people who are the role models. Don't go back and look and, you know, look at useless people sitting in jails, etc. What are you going to get? You want to compare yourself with them? Bad idea. So look at anye apare sadhavah ye santi tesham vrittam ati api alochaya. So look at all the holy people, the stalwarts, the exalted people. How do I know they're exalted? Because other people consider them so. Yeah. Because you find people going and honoring them. You find people increasingly turning to them for advice, suggestions on how to lead their life. You find people being lauded, applauded in society. You find such people getting honors and awards. You find people, such people not always trying to go to litigations, learning to let, who know how to let things go and just be in their own glory. Such people you seek and look among them in the contemporary society. First you look at your own lineage and the past of this glorious culture. And now you look at the people who matter. Anye sadhavaha, those sadhus that are there, ye santi. You know, tesham vrittam, their conduct also you analyze. You know, what for? Let us see. Yeah, sadhavah yatha vartante, how they behave, tamscha, that behavior, pratipashya alochaya. Pratipashya means look towards them, look up to them and see what they are doing.
Tatha
na chateshu
mrishakaranam
vrittam
vartamanam va asti.
Yeah, he has to fill, this is a very cryptic verse, so he has to fill in a lot of blanks. So, and then he says, na tesham, you will not find among them, tesham among them, or teshu, yeah, among them, the same thing. So seventh case, no, na teshu vishaya saptami. Among them, you will not have, you know, not vishaya saptami, teshu, among them, just regular saptami. So, na teshu mrishakaranam vrittam vartamanam va asti. Vartamanam, vartamane, in the present time. Na teshu, among them, you will not find any kind of behaviors of prevaricating the truth, bending the truth. Mrishakaranam means falsifying what they said. That means bending the truth to suit their situation, to suit their, ease, to suit their, to be conducive to what they want, to suit their ragadveshas. You will not find that. Yeah. You look everywhere. You will not, you are not going to find it. And therefore what? Therefore, it behooves you to behave like them. And in so saying, he is saying that, you know, but for this little moment that you are having of anxiety, you belong with the sadhus in the present day. He is looking upon his father as a sadhu. And he says, you belong in their ranks. So therefore, you should look at them and see vartamanam teshu mrishakaranam, the pre-verification of the truth, bending the truth, moving away from the truth, vrittam vartamanam na asti, you will not see that, nava asti, not at all you will see, tad viparitam asatam cha vrittam mrishakaranam. Yeah. Tad viparitam, the opposite of this, you know, the opposite of this, what is that? Asatam. Here is satam, sadhavah is satam. Sat means those who, not only truth, but those who follow the truth. Sat jananam, sat jananam. And here is asatam. Asatam means the ones who don't follow the truth. And interestingly enough, the same word is used for among those who are non-existent. So first is sadhus among those who count. Why? Because they are given to sat. Yeah, and I told you yesterday sat and satyam are closely aligned, because that internal duality between the thinker and the doer and the, you know, and the thinker and the actor is not there. That's why there is an inner oneness that makes the preparation for the seeking the, discovering the outer oneness as the truth of oneself very easy. So here, you know, he is giving the two scenarios. Satam, sadhavaha, ye vartante, those who are there, who are sat janaha, who are good people. Good people means people who count among those that exist. And asatam, because their behavior is so bad that you don't count them among the living. Yes. Because they are in a place of self-denial. Asanne vasabhavati asad brahmeti veda chet. And if you deny the truth, you become non-existent. Whether it's the truth, the ultimate truth of yourself as whole, limitless, or whether it's a small little truth here, you know, concerning denying what you've said. Doesn't matter, it's both are forms of self-denial. This is more of a psychological self-denial. That is the ultimate absolute self-denial. This is on the relative plane. That is on the plane of the absolute. And so really, when you tell a lie, the person you're hurting the most is who? Yourself. Because you become non-existent. So he says, that's why he gives the contrast. He concedes that right now in the world, there are sat and asat, both. Meaning there are good people and people who don't behave that well either. They are also there. But what's the difference? The difference is that you want to emulate the former and not even look at the latter. Yeah. You make the person who, you know, who lies non-existent, because they themselves are, you know, lying out of a sense of insecurity and helplessness and fear. And so really speaking, when they indulge in this habitual lies, they become non-existent in the sense that it's like the story of that fairy tale. The boy who cried wolf. Yeah, I was wondering what it was. Yeah, so, you know, the boy who cried the wolf. you know, he was a shepherd, and he made a joke, a prank on all his friends, other cowherds, shepherds, and he said, "Wolf is coming, wolf is coming." Everybody ran. Second time also everybody ran and scrambled to take their animals to safety because the wolf is coming for the animals. All the sheep, goats, cows, everybody took. And then what? Third time, nobody believed. And third time the wolf really came, but no, he had lost his veracity. This is what the thing is. So here, after that, nobody believes you. I mean, you may say something very objective, sky is blue, still they will say he is lying, she is lying, they will say that. So it's not about the people who don't count. Look at the people who count, he says. That vipritam, you know, means any kind of a conduct which results in denial of what one said is called mrishakaranam, you know, ajaram. So mrishakaranam means a falsification. Yeah. So then, na cha mrisha kritva kashchit ajaramaro bhavati. And then furthermore, another reason not to engage in mrishakaranam. Mrishakaranam means falsification. And another reason, first is the reason right here, right now, we have given that. And also, he says, I don't know of anyone who has gained heaven by indulging in lies. Because why does he keep bringing up heaven? Because that's where the father has packed his bags to go. With everything that is being given away, he is packing now the toothbrush, now the soap, all these things he is packing one by one. With more things being given away, his seat in heaven is being reserved. There is a big reserved board on the velvet seat for him in heaven, right in the dress circle box of Rambha's dance, you know. And only after going there he'll know that I don't want this, but right now he's fascinated by heaven and he is heaven bound. You know, he's booked his ticket, he's reserved his seat, and now he's packing his bags through the Vishvajit Yajna. This is what is happening. So now what happens? Then he says that, you know, nacha mrishakritva, you know, no one has gone to heaven. We don't know of anyone who has become ajara amara relatively. You know, amara means free of death. Relatively, not absolutely. Heaven is not eternal for us. It's just a place where Yama is denied visa. Yeah, that's all it is. You know, the current prime minister elect was denied US visa. Yes, in 2005. Nobody was giving him visa. Now they are all welcoming him. So the phones are going every day. And so now, this is the thing. Now, you know, so like that, Yama was denied visa by Indra. You know, and even if Yama becomes some big shot, he will always, because this is a rule that in heaven, Yama doesn't get visa. Not even a visa to visit someone. No. That's why Nachiketa will later say, Swarge loke, you know, he says that lots of wonderful things are there. But the best of things in the Swargaloka is natatratvam. You don't come feature there in heaven at any time. Na jaraya bibheti. You know, there is no old age in heaven. And there is no Yama in heaven. So this is a relative freedom from Yama and things that lead to Yama. You know, what are the things that lead to Yama? Old age. Yeah. So, if death is not there, old age also, what is the use of having old age? Old age is only for the sake of death. Otherwise, there is no reason to have old age. Yeah, old age is just to show that yes, you know, one more thing has stopped functioning. And you wake up in the morning, one eye doesn't open. And then you wake up the next day, one hand doesn't function. And then you wake up the third day and find that the one leg is also not functioning. And then belatedly, you know, the person concludes, oh, maybe that was a stroke. The stroke of insight comes much later. You know, so this is all bringing one closer. Every day, one is getting closer and closer to Lord Yama. Every single day, you wake up closer to Lord Yama than you were the day before. This is a fact. And finally, one day, there will be an embrace. literally he will take you out, you know, yeah, for an extraterrestrial stroll. This is all it is. You say, let's go, Jiva, except you're on a leash. That's all. That leash is called Asha Pasha, you know, and the leash is not, he is not making up the leash. It's made of your own fears and desires. Asha Pasha is your doggy leash. And you means the body, not the body. Body you have left behind. The you, Jiva. So then the Jiva goes on a extraterrestrial stroll with a doggy leash. And then the leash leads you to various other things. Because sometimes, you know, when you see, when I go for a walk, I have a doubt whether the dog is walking the person or the person is walking the dog. Some dogs trot along the masters, no problem. And other dogs, sometimes they are big, you know, huge fellows. They are running and the person is trying to keep up behind them. So the force of the desires, Yama is just holding on to direct it. But sometimes the force of the desires try to escape Lord Yama and just go and dash off on their own. So Asha Pasha Shatair Baddha, like by you know, having a thousand nooses in the form of desire, the Jiva, you know, gets picked up by Lord Yama. You know, like you the FedEx person comes and takes the package. Yeah. And then drops it off somewhere else. That is exactly Lord Yama. Yes. Except that, you know, people on earth don't call him FedEx. What do they call him? Fed up X. Yeah. Because they are fed up of the thought of Lord Yama. Nobody more. You see, there are no temples for Lord Yama. No temples. You don't want to invoke. In India, you will not find a single temple. And also, there are no drawings either. So what if there is not a temple? I'll use a photograph. Try to find a photo of Lord Yama. You will not find. Some recently, through popular imagination, they'll make a scary fellow sitting on a bull and having horns on the crown and all these things. But really, there is no depiction. Yeah. Because this is most unsavory. And therefore, you know, since moksha they think is unattainable, or they don't know what it is. Moksha means being free and here and now from the clutches of Lord, eager clutches of Lord Yama. You know, being free right now and not being afraid of endings, because I know myself to be the truth of everything. And I'm here to stay. I'm changeless consciousness. I'm purna, whole. Not knowing that is a very costly mistake. And so, because of this mistake, what happens is that you start looking for some substitutes. Because this whole life is about substitutes. You can have eyes without having eyes, transplanted from something else. You can have a heart without having a heart, pacemaker. You know, you can have teeth, of course, without having teeth. You can have hips without having hips, knees without having knees. Everything is substitute. Even when cooking, substitute. You know, everything. Substitute, you know, people who don't eat egg, there is some egg substitute. I don't know what it is, you know, but sounds frightening, but they say it is vegetarian, yeah. Chicken is also vegetarian, but anyhow, so it may eat some bugs, but maybe it's not. So we don't know what is in this egg substitute. And then some people cannot eat this, because again, vegetarian problem, you cannot eat this, what is that made from the hoof of the cow?
It's gelatin.
Gelatin, correct. This gelatin also has a substitute. What is that? It is the weed of the sea. Agar, you know? Yeah. And then, of course, the jelly will not be so nice looking, and it will be a very scaredy cat. It will wobble a little more than the other jelly. You know? Yeah. The jelly means that which doesn't gel. You know, here, in this case. Not with gels. That's why it's called jelly. So that which doesn't gel properly, thanks to this fellow's vegetarian sentiments. And then there is one more thing, which is there in most cheeses, you know, other than feta cheese or pot.
Rennet.
That is also coming from another body part of the cow, intestines. Yeah. For that also there is a substitute now. Yeah. What is the substitute? Soya cheese. Some soya cheese also has rennet. You know, yeah, soya cheese. You know the best way to eat it? You bring it home, open the wrapper, consume the wrapper and throw the cheese. It's the same caloric value, same taste. Yeah. Eat the cardboard, throw away the cheese. That's really what it is. Tastes horrid. And this is what the whole thing is. But the whole life is about substitutes. And we can get by with substitutes. And then what? We have substitutes in the puja also. Because this fellow sits for a big worship without having any of the ingredients. Lazy devotee. And then the lazy devotee says, "Oh Lord, today I'm in a rush. Couldn't get everything together. So what? So, you know, I have this all-round substitute called akshata." What is akshata? Rice covered with turmeric and little ghee. You rub the rice with ghee. Just because, you know, you can do so, and then it will take on the color of the turmeric. So yellow raw grains of rice in a little bowl, the fellow will keep in the shrine room. And then what will the person do? You know, I didn't even bring the water to wash your feet. So, padyartham akshatan samarpayami. Asanartham, I have a nice throne to put you on. Asanartham akshatan samarpayami. And then what? Don't have anything to give you to offer to drink, you know. And then what? Here, akshatan samarpayami. No tea. Instead of tea, have, you know, akshata. Pretend it is tea. Because you are all pervasive, all knowledgeable, everything. You should be able to make everything out of everything. Who am I? Even if I give tea, real tea, that is as good as akshata for you, because you made akshata, you made tea. Now out of this akshata, make your own tea, you know. And then what? Then there is no naivedya, because forgot to go to the market and buy fruits for the puja. So therefore what? Naivedyartham for akshatan samarpayami. Everything akshatan, akshatan. So this substitution is possible. So the mind substitutes the finite for the infinite very easily. There is an overlay, a seamless overlay. And so instead of moksha, because moksha is so hard, you have to find the guru first. Oh my God! You know, why you have to do all that? And you have to study something called Upanishad. Who has heard that? I tried to read one line and it put me to sleep. So I'm certainly not doing that when there seems to be a shortcut. What is the shortcut? Just give away things, you know, call the brahmanas, make them happy, make them fat, feed them, send them home. And then what? Then you'll go to heaven. That's all. And the heaven also is called Ajara Amara, means Lord Yama has no entry there. Lord Yama can do 100 yajnas. In fact, he admits it, but he still cannot go to heaven. This is the ironic, you know, whatever punishment in the form of Punarjanma he got. Very sweet, very sweetly he admits it later. And then he says, you know, so here, you know, the thing is, you go for the relative because you feel either you don't know that the absolute is a possibility, or you are averse to the absolute for some reasons of hopelessness or despair. So you substitute the relative for the absolute, like salt substitute, sugar substitute, like this. And so you substitute heaven for that eternity which you yourself are, that you are yet to discover. So this is what he says. And then so, Vajashrava is there right now. Having made the complete substitution, he has put a superimposition on heaven as being the cat's cream, the only place to go. And he has already booked a condo in heaven by all his good deeds. And then Nachiketa plays upon his sentiments and says, "I don't know of anyone whose booked seat was not cancelled after all these lies." Even you know, this is not like the Christian salvation. In Christian concept of salvation, you have to declare a few things. You have to declare that someone died for you, Christ died for you, even though you were not yet born, died not for you but for your sins. And so you are absolved of all the sins because you believe him to be the savior. You have to declare that, and you have to say, "I am saved." And then after that, you can go rob a bank. Nothing will happen. Yeah, this is the idea. I don't know if that is what is written in the Bible, but this is how people internalize it. I am saved. I am immune. This is not some kind of a diplomatic immunity where it takes away the responsibility from your own, actions. But a lot of people seem to appear to interpret it in this way, and it's very, very problematic, because what happens as a result is that one stops being accountable. The Hindu tradition is not like that. You may have done a wonderful thing, lot of great things, and then they have dusted your seat, as I told you, and brushed the velvet from the, you know, seat, so that it's all, it's piling up nicely and looks wonderful, and your name is there with reserved board, you know, VVIP, reserved, V for Vajashrava, and the other VIP. But then if you start hedging the truth, hedging around the truth, then what happens? The reserved board is taken off, your name is taken off, someone else's name is put, even at the last minute. That's why you have to lead a very, you know, mindful and alert life. This is not like, you know, oh, once I have secured a place in heaven, it cannot be undone. It's very, very flimsy. It can be undone in a trice, as Mrs. Yami is about to tell. She's fixing to say this later on, very soon, in fact. And so, therefore, you have to be mindful. So he says that, you know, I don't know of anyone who climbed the ladder to heaven using the rungs of falsehood. So mrishakaranena nakaschit, you know, how does it say, nakaschit ajara amaro bhavati, yeah. So no one, mrishakritva, same thing, mrishakaranena, by falsification of and flubbing through their words, nobody gets even the relative freedom from, you know, life after life, so from samsara. Yataha sasyamiva martyaha manushyaha pachyate jirno mriyate. Yeah, yataha means yasmat karunat, because of which, you know, that he gives the reasoning now. Sasyamiva, sasyam means just like a, you know, green, something like a weed, like a plant, some kind of plant, grain, anything. Sasya. So, you know, like we have this word again, prithivi sasya shalini, that sasya, green, the greenery. So, like grass, you know, grass grows, spinach grows, anything grows, and then what? It grows, it dies. Then suddenly the sun comes, the summer sun, and scorches it, no rain, it dies. And then rain comes, what happens? Grows back again. And how many times does it do it? As many times as there are seasons. Keeps doing it. You know, interminably, this is the life of the sasya. Do you miss the sasya that has gone? No. And do you, you know, have a big band to welcome it when it comes back? This is a non-event, correct? So the greenery of the earth, dying and coming back to life, is a non-event, as long as it keeps going on. Yeah. This is a problematic example for Eugene, but anyhow. Where, you know, everything is an event connected to ecology. But anyhow, so for whatever it is worth. So this is a non-event. I mean, who is even, do you count how many blades of grass are in your lawn? No. You don't do that. It's a non-event. It's just there and you take it for granted. It's not there. Oh, you said summer has come. You say, oh, summer has come. It's gone. Then it's, winter has come. It has gone under. Now it will come back. You know. Then it comes back. So nobody gives it a thought. So manushyaha, even the human beings, birth and death, not from the standpoint of the family that is celebrating the birth and the family that is mourning the death, but from the standpoint of the collective of how things are, it's a non-event. Because the greenery also, the weeds and the grasses, grow, die, grow, die. And what does the human being do? Grow, die, grow, die. Comes into being, goes out of being. What do they do? Nothing. And so the greenery is not missed, but the human being is missed, correct? Why? Because what they leave behind matters. The greenery doesn't have a free will to aspire to be the most truthful blade of grass that ever lived. It doesn't have that thing. It doesn't have that, desire. It's incapable of having a desire. It leads a life programmed by nature and leads a life completely devoted to the mercy of the elements. The sun can scorch it and something, rain can bring it back, the earth, you know, sustains it or not. If the earth is scorched, it doesn't sustain it. So it's completely at the mercy of the elements. And so therefore, and you know, the wind takes it to repollinate somewhere else. It doesn't have any volition. But here, yataha sasyamiva, like even the greenery, martyaha manushyaha, martyaha the mortal, meaning the human being, manushyaha, pachyate. Pachyate literally means cooks. You know, like the grass is cooked by the sun, you know. Here, cooks means what? You know, this is very interesting analogy here. First 40 years of your life, you cook and eat the food. You are in charge. You cook, you decide what to make, and you proceed to eat it. And then after the 40th year, the food cooks you from inside out. Yeah. You cook the food outside and take it in, and then it begins to cook you inside out. That's why you say, I cannot have sugar. I cannot have that gluten. I cannot have this. And so as you grow older, the repertoire of things that you cannot be eaten keeps growing and growing and growing and growing. Yeah. And then what? You live on dal and water. And the water on top of the lentils. You have to throw away the lentils and drink the water. You can put a pinch of cumin for digestion, because even that doesn't get digested. This is the condition. This is what is called jirna. Jirna means the person becomes threadbare. And I'm connecting it to the cooking, because the Shruti uses the word pachyate. This is what is pachyate. Because the food has to take revenge. Because you have, you know, been... you have been so mean to the food. You have bashed it, you have cut it up, you have chopped it, you have put it in hot water. Oh my God, you have even put it in hot oil and called it pakodas. And you know, you have done, you know, you have treated the food with so much, you know, ignoble, you know, ideas and thoughts. And the brinjal and the, you know, what is that, bhindi or okra, they have a pact, you know. The brinjal says, just wait for a couple of years. You know, I'm going to make this fellow allergic to nightshades, not only me, but all the other things that this fellow only likes to eat. Because generally, people who are allergic to something love only that thing. This is the principle of Ayurveda. We will be hearing what Dr. Hari says about this. What you should not eat, the diabetic will love sugar, you know, and the person with cholesterol wants to bathe in ghee. And then the person who should not eat, you know, spicy food will always like spicy food. This is what it is. This is the way of the world. You know, this is designed to get vairagya quickly. That's all it is. And the body helps. And so the food gangs up. So the potato asks the brinjal, you know, were you also sliced and put in a cool batter only to be dropped in hot oil? Brinjal nods its head. Yes, that's what happened to me. And they called me pakodas, bondas. And, oh, you are called pakoda, I am called bonda, potato says. And then I don't, you know, and they say, not only that, first thing, before, at least you were straight away chopped and put into the oil after the batter. And I thought the batter would protect, but no, the heat came searing through. But for me, I had more ignominious treatment. First I was peeled, my whole skin was taken out. Then I was dropped into hot water and boiled. And then a huge, you know, wrecking ball called the potato masher came and flattened me completely. And then I was, you know, chili powder and everything was put, you know. And then I was made into balls, dipped in. See, you see, I have more of a grudge to bear. And then the bell pepper says, what are you talking about? Bell pepper and tomato are going for a walk. What are you talking about? Well, we are talking about how difficult it is. And bell pepper says, you know what? These Hindus didn't even know I existed. No, I'm actually a foreigner. You know? I am British, and I came from, you know, depending, the tomato says, I am British, and I am English actually. And they didn't even know us. And what did they do? They started to grow us in their own shores, and then cut up and, you know, fry us with paneer and all these things, and then do horrible things to us. So this is the ultimate rebellion of the nightshades. Yeah. And nightshades means they take all the shades out of you. The living daylights, they scare out of you. Each time you eat them, what happens? They cook you from inside. You suddenly don't feel so good. You know, you just resemble a blimp because they cause bloating. And then, you know, they cause all kinds of problems. So they just cook you from inside. And then what? Okra comes into the picture. Okra says, yeah, this is very hazardous. You know, I too have been fried. I too have been deep fried. Even though I have a mechanism so that nobody eats me, I ooze this substance as soon as I'm cut, especially by the Western hand, which doesn't know how to cut me. I ooze this substance to scare them off. But still they persist in making mumbo jumbo gumbo. And okra says, I'm vegetarian, but I have to live next to the meat in this gumbo dish. And I'm having a hard life. I'm going to cause allergy. As soon as the fellow sets his eyes on me, the eyes start to water. Cannot even look at me. I'm going to ensure my own survival. So this is the combined rebellion of all the vegetables that you have ever laid your eyes on or your knife on. Yes. And the onion takes immediate revenge. Yeah. No sooner you put the knife, it makes you. Yeah, this is called drishtaphalam. You know, immediate revenge it takes. Doesn't even wait till later. Yeah. And the garlic is very patient. It says, I'm going to chase you. You know, in every orifice I will be available for 72 hours after you have ingested me. And all your friends and loved ones will depart from you. They won't want to come near you. This is the collective rebellion of the vegetables. What if you are non-vegetarian? That's why you have mad cow disease. It's just the cows mad. Mad at being how they are treated, mad at being eaten. And then the chicken flu. This is what it is. Not F-L-E-W. F-L-U. Yeah, this is all. Pachyate. Sasyamiva martyaha pachyate. Even like the food the manushya cooks, manushya is cooked by the food. It's very interesting. You know, jirno bhavati, as a result, gives up on all food, dies away, and then what? You know, jirno bhavati mriyate cha, you know, and then what? Mriyate cha, mritva katham karoti, you know, what does he do after dying? Mritvacha sasyamiva ajayate avirbhavati punarevam anitye jivaloke kim rishakaranena. Yeah, so mritvacha, having died also, there is no peace. What happens? Jayate, ajayate. Ajayate means comes back like a bad coin. Yeah. You know, how did that expression come? I think only from, you know, trying to pump. In those days there were no banks and which you could go to exchange torn currency and bad coins. So you try to hide it with some good coins and palm it off. And then you feel very good. And later on you buy something and the grocer gives you back that. Even though you didn't give the grocer, but it came around. That is the expression. So like a bad coin, which is not to be used in currency, this fellow is always in currency. Yes. He's always in circulation. Who? This human being. Never out of circulation. Always in circulation. This time worm, next time, you know, squirm, you know, in some other way. And then some other life. Cow, chicken, first cow, then eater of cow, then back to cow. You know, this is all these kinds of, you know, janmas. Yatha karma, yatha shrutam, as the Shruti promises, and according to one's karma, all these lifetimes, the jiva is never, you know, out of circulation in and through all these lifetimes. So he says, mritvacha, having died, sasyamiva, like even the ignoble grasses, ajayate punaha. Ajayate means what? Comes back. And he explains it with a wonderful word, avir bhavati, avis plus bhavati. It's a kind of a avihi is a avis, avihi is a special word where the terms avihi and tiras both, you know. So avihi means the avis, avihi, how to explain, like where the, like for example avir bhavanam, let us take avir bhavati. You know, bhavati means comes, becomes. But when you add avi to it, avis to it, it means that the terms of the coming are not negotiable in by you. There is some kind of a intervention, which is Bhagavan's intervention is there. So avir bhavati means magically, as it were, comes back. Magically is not the correct word, but just for your understanding, I'm using it. Avir bhavati. And then what? Tiro bhavati. Tiras, you know, means again, tiro bhavati means vanishes without a trace, meaning that in its vanishing, there was some other hand. Unexplainably comes, as it were. That's better. Unexplainably, unexplained by human logic, you know, because the logic cannot explain rebirth. And why this person, you know, was born like a, why this jiva was born as a worm? Can anyone explain? No, only Bhagavan. That's why avir bhavati. Like whenever avatara comes also we say avir bhutam. Avir bhutam cha srishtyadav prakrite ev purushat param. Kutra, where?
Evam dhyayati yo nityam sayogi yoginam vara. Namo. Namo.
It takes a while for the takes a while for the thing to. So there also avir bhutam. I'm using the same word here. Avir bhavati, there bhutam already happened. So avir bhutam cha srishtyadav, the one that has unexplainably, you know, what is it? You know, manifest in the form of the whole jagat, in the srishti, manifest as the creation, unexplainably, without any logic. Because you don't see Bhagavan entering, you know, creeping into the everything in the creation. You don't see that. So therefore, this that which has a celestial intervention, that which is unexplained by human logic, that which has Bhagavan there, wherever there is, it is called avir bhutam. So here avir bhavati means yatha karma yatha shrutam. Avir bhavati doesn't just bhavati. Bhavati means you can decide what you want to be next life. And next life I want to be born in, you know, Dubai, because I want to be rich, I want to be an oil seller or whatever it is. You know, you can't decide. You can't even say that next life I want to be a human being, even that is not in your hands. So therefore this is avir bhavanam. So avir bhavati, he explains it. I mean, Adi Shankara is so tight and so compact. It is just so beautiful to look at each word here. Avir bhavati punarevam. Punarevam means again and again. Where anitye jivaloke. In this jivaloka, the only thing which is nitya, which is eternal about the jivaloka, is this samsara, is that it is always anitya. That's the only nitya thing about it. That it is nityam anityam. You know, this is what this jivaloka means, this world of populated by other jivas. Because that's how your karma will get exhausted. Yeah. First you have to be exhausted, then your karma gets exhausted, then you cook the food, and then the food cooks you, and then sends you straight to the grave, and then sends the body straight to the grave, out of which various kinds of avir bhavanam takes place. Yeah. Because of the karma, we don't know how the person comes back. And then what? So Anitya Jiva Loke is brought out for another reason, because it is to show that Nachiketa is telling his father that life is extremely short, in which you come back, make many rounds, just like even the grasses grow and die and grow and die, the person also grows and dies. And between one life, the birth and the death, which are the bookends of this life, you know, even though you are born again, you don't remember anything, so what's the use? So you have to only look at this life. You can only look at this life. Anitya Jiva Loke, in this, where everything is finite, another meaning, in which everything is finite, you know, what is your mark? Why do you want to spoil this finite life of finite means and ends with a big, you know, strike against you? Why do you want to leave, go like that? Kim Rishakaranena, what do you get out of lying? In this short life that is marked by the pains of birth and death, and then again rebirth because of your actions. Kim Rishakaranena, this is a typical way of asking a rhetorical question in Sanskrit. You put Kim, and then you put the word that is to be meditated or contemplated upon in the negative, in the third case. Yeah. Kim Vrishakaranena, what do you get by this? See, that by is in the third case. What do you get by this? Vrishakaranam means by this falsification. What did you get? In this short life, you should aspire and strive to make it meaningful. And the only way you can make it meaningful is doing what the sasya cannot do. The sasya cannot tell truth and get an award, but you can. So therefore, it behoves you to act in keeping with the tradition and in keeping with all the stalwarts of this age. That is the idea. So then he says, Kim Rishakaranena Palaya Atmanas Satyam.
Atmanas Satyam.
Yeah, Atmanah Satyam Palaya. Protect yourself, which is protecting the truth. Protect yourself by going with the truth. Protect your truth means, you know, protect your words here. Satyata, not of the Atma, but Atmanah Shabdasya. Satyata, Satyatam Palaya. So you please protect the, you know, the truth of your words. How to protect the truth of the words? Preshaya,
maam,
yamaya,
iti
abhiprayaha. Yeah. Send me to Yama. How to protect the words? How to protect the truth of your words? What did you say? Go to Yama. So send me there now. And then Anandagiri, or somebody, I don't know, it's not Anandagiri, I didn't find it in the morning when I read it, Anandagiri Tika, but there was one more Tika, I forgot who it was, that said that how did Nachiketa go? Because this is, you know, Preshaya, it is easy to say. Preshaya means send, you know. This is not putting something in the mail. You know, this is not going to the mailbox and putting it there and hoping someone will pick it up. This is not like that. How to send? And so that Tikakara says, that particular Tikakara, I forgot who it was, says that tapasa preshaya. Like, you know, because in those days where truth prevailed and the sankalpa was itself everything. So tapasa means through the intention. You know, you just had a strong and intention. And the strong intention is called satya sankalpa, on part of one who is free of desires, relatively free of desires. So when someone who is free of desires prays, then that comes true. So here, the child, of course, was such a pure-hearted soul. The child and the father sat together and prayed, and then he was beamed up into Yama's world. That is the explanation, in case anyone is wondering how they, you know, how he went. So, tapasa preshaya iti samtikakara says. Saha
eva muktaha
pita
atmanaha
सत्यतायै
प्रेषयामास
सः मीन्स् हू हि यू नो हू इस् दिस् हि द वन् हू वास् अड्रेस्ड् दस् हू वास् अड्रेस्ड् दस् वाजश्रवस् पिता दट् फादर् हू वास् दस् अड्रेस्ड् आत्मनः सत्यतायै इन् आर्डर् टु प्रोटेक्ट् हिस् ओन् ट्रूथ्फुल्नेस् प्रेषयामास Who did he preshofai? Yeah, Nachiketa. So, he sent Nachiketa. How? I already explained. Tapasa. And then what? The story moves very quickly. So, we have to do a lot of interpretation. And so, he sent him through the power of the tapas. Because it was a holy place. Maybe the Brahmanas helped chant a few more mantras. And then off he went. And then, yeah, and then what? Sacha.
Sacha.
Yama bhavanam gatva.
Yama bhavanam gatva.
Tisro ratrihi.
Tisro ratrihi.
Uvasa.
Uvasa.
Yame proshite.
Yame proshite.
Yeah, so there is too much proshanam happening. So first was his own preshanam. Preshanam means sending. And what did he do? He arrived safely, reached safely. What did he reach? Yama Bhavanam, the palatial lodgings of Lord Yama. Yeah, what a waste, because hardly he is there to enjoy it. Very busy he is, you know. And I described his lodgings in detail. Italian garden with statues, marble, stone bench, and then all these, you know, trees and waterfalls and what are they? Fountains. I told you that. Yeah. This was what his palace looked like. Yeah. So, but this was by another Tikakara. So, a contemporary Tikakara. So, this was his palace. Palatial. Bhavanam means, you know, it's not a Yama Griham. No, Yama lives in a palace. He's a celestial. And, you know, well, you know, very well kept lawns and, you know, wonderful, very nice. And then if it was the Western Greek Yama, he would have a one-eyed dog gamboling in the aforementioned lawn called Cyclops. Yeah, but this is Hindu Yama. And so even actually in Hindu Yama also dogs are associated. It's very interesting. There is some kind of a pervasive, you know, there's kind of these myths are all pervasive. Yama is associated with dogs, yeah, pet dogs he had, and that's why I got that whole leash idea from. So anyway, now he went to Lord Yama's house, having reached there safely through the power of Sankalpa and Tapas. And Gatva, what did he do having gone there? Tisro Ratrihi, you know, Tisraha Ratrihi, 3 nights. Uvasa. Uvasa means stayed, lived. Yeah. Uvasa, long time ago, lived. And lived means what? Did not move into his house and in the room. I told you he was on the stone bench inside the compound in the front yard. Like standing there like a sore thumb. And you know, Yami kept checking her blood pressure because it was going to dangerous heights, seeing him there. Yeah. And so, then what was the problem? Why did he stay outside? Yame proshite sati. Because this is the absolute locative construction. And what is that? What is the condition of his staying outside for 3 nights was predicated by the fact that Yama himself had been sent away on work. What work?
To bring back
Jeeva. That's all. Yeah, FedEx work. That's all. He went to pick up some packages, and he was not at home for 3 days and 3 nights. So you see, that is how the locative construction works. The locative construction has to have 2 conditions. This condition is incumbent upon or dependent upon that condition. So why did he stay outside for 3 nights and 3 days is explained by the fact that he himself was not there. Meaning, Nachiketa was so responsible. He says, I have come to see Yama. And until I am greeted by him, I have come to serve him.
I cannot just come and take the hospitality in the absence of the host. Yami says, hello, I am also the hostess. No, I didn't come to see you, I came to see him. He's, you know, very, very high ethical standards. And then what happens? Proshya agatam.
Proshya agatam.
Yamam.
Yamam.
Amatyaha bharyaha va.
Amatyaha
bharyaha va.
Bharyaha va.
Ujuhu.
Ujuhu.
Bodhayantaha.
Bodhayantaha.
Yeah. So, now, the proshya agatam yamam. Unto that Yama, who finally came back from his travels, who was sent and then who came back. Sent also shows Yama is not acting on his own will. Yeah. He is following the laws of Bhagavan, Ishvara. So, proshya agataya yamaya, for this Yama, who came back after being sent, what happened for him? You know, uchuhu, somebody said. Who was this somebody? Either wife or the attendants. I don't think it was attendants, because the way he is addressed, attendants will not address him by the first name. Yeah. Amatya means servants. Servants will not address by the first name. So it was definitely Yami herself. So Yami says to him, and what she says to him, she bodhayantaha means makes him understand. And what she makes him understand, we will see soon. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.